Day broadcast. My name is Betty and I will be your host today. I myself study here at Maastricht University, however at a different faculty, therefore rest assured that most of the information mentioned today will be as new to me as it is to you. We are now here at the Faculty of Maastricht Science program, and as you can see through the window behind me, there are many guests during the open day today. Our program will consist of interviews with the academic staff, current students, as well as of videos that will show you more details about the life at Maastricht Science program. You can ask questions whenever throughout the broadcast, and we will collect them and answer them in the end. But for now, just have a cup of tea, cup of coffee, and enjoy. But before we proceed, let's take a quick look at a short video about the highlights from the morning of the open day today. And welcome back. Then let's jump right into the interviews. I'm here with Birgit Blum, who is a chemistry lecturer here at the Maastricht Science program. Hello. Welcome.
Hi.
Welcome in the broadcast.
Thank you.
So let's start a bit broadly. What is Maastricht Science program? Can you tell us more about it?
Well, the Maastricht Science program is here in the Faculty of Humanities and Sciences at the University of Maastricht. And it is a natural sciences program, which is pretty new and innovative, which started about 7 years ago. The program delivers Bachelor of Science students in the natural sciences, and we have a very open curriculum, meaning that the students can choose their own courses in the disciplines of chemistry, physics, biology, mathematics, but also interdisciplinary courses. So it's an open curriculum, it's very student-centered, and those are our values here.
You said interdisciplinary. What can I imagine behind that?
We're living in a time now where discipline-defined research is sort of giving way to more interdisciplinary sciences. So we have, of course, the discipline-defined subjects available, with corresponding practical courses or skills, but we also have interdisciplinary subjects that the students can take sort of at the interface of, for example, chemistry and physics or chemistry and biology, and so that is a part of our program as well.
So is it then up to the student's decision what he or she wants to study, or how does the whole process work?
Yes, the students really have the autonomy to choose the subjects and the direction that they want to take. The first semester of the first year is predefined. The students have to take certain mandatory courses. But from the second semester, right up until the end of their degree, they can choose which direction they want to go in. So it's highly flexible. Some students will, for example, decide to take a mixture of subjects, a bit of chemistry, biology, and physics. And other students will, for example, focus exclusively on one of those disciplines, for example, chemistry. So it's highly flexible because different students want to do different things after their bachelor's studies. Some want to go on with master's programs, others want to maybe go into something like patent law, for example. So we offer a broad spectrum of courses so that the student can tailor their studies for what they want to do when they're finished.
And could you maybe tell us more about the educational techniques that are used here at the faculty?
Well, Maastricht University is really very progressive in terms of teaching. And in line with that, in our program, we use something called problem-based learning, which is used university-wide. And problem-based learning is a student-centered learning approach. It's highly innovative and modern. And basically, instead of having, well, we do have traditional lectures as well, but what we also have is PBL, or problem-based learning, where essentially the students will sit around a table up to groups of about 12 and be confronted with a problem that's part of the course that they're doing, and solve that problem. It could be in the form of a text, or you know, some sort of something that they have to work through, using a seven-step approach. This is very good because the students really get into the problem themselves with a lot of understanding. It's very student-centered, so the whole dynamic is driven by the students. The whole idea is that the staff member doesn't get involved too much in this process, but that's the students solve the problem. And also, they learn to work as a team, and I think that those are very valuable skills. So it's a very innovative didactic tool that we use here, very widely.
You said it's usually a group of 12 students,
yes.
So that makes it very small scale, right?
Correct. We are really proud of our staff-to-student ratio here, which is really excellent. It is sort of like a college atmosphere, very small classes, excellent access to the lecturers and professors. So, we, for example, have classes of typically 20 to 30 students. In the first year, which is the biggest class you will ever have here, will be about 60 students. So it's very small, and I think that's really a huge plus for an undergraduate student.
Well, in general, Maastricht University is one of the most international universities in the whole Europe. Could you maybe reflect a bit on how it looks like here at the Maastricht Science Faculty?
It's highly, highly international. We have more than 70 different nationalities here in our program, which is very colourful and exciting. I think this is also very good for our students to come into contact with all these different cultures, because that is, after all, the direction the world is moving in. So I think that's great. I think it makes for a very lively and exciting student body here at the program, and we're very proud of the fact that we have such an international student body.
Well, that's also the reason why we're doing the broadcast, right? Because not everybody is able to come to the open day, since the students are all around the world, really. And yeah, well, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you
for
very much
giving us some insight into how the Maastricht Science program looks like.
Thanks for having me.
And we'll be seeing you at the end of the broadcast when it comes to answering the most important questions, of course. But for now, let's take a look at a short video that will illustrate you how the Maastricht Science Program community and the faculty itself looks like. We'll be right back. Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. I'm Betty, and I'm here with our second interviewee, who is Erik Steen Redeker, who is a lecturer of synthetic biology. I'm sorry, and he's going to tell us a bit more about academic advising that takes place here at Maastricht Science Programme. Mm-hmm. So, just to set it all straight, could you please tell us what is academic advising?
Yeah. So academic advising is, we as a program, we offer a broad range of courses, mm-hmm. going from the basic levels of chemistry, biology, and physics and math, but also interdisciplinary courses. And the students can basically build their own curriculum around their personal interest or around a specific master they want to go to when they finish here. We as academic advisors basically are the bridge between the students and the university, and we try to help them building their curriculum mm-hmm. around a specific topic they want to go. Because if they have so many courses they can choose from, it's sometimes hard to choose the right courses.
I can imagine that, yes. So how does this work? How many academic advisors are there for a student, or what is the whole process? How does
the whole process is that in the beginning, when the students start at our program, they get a list of questions, and based on that list of questions or the answers, they get appointed to a specific advisor which has the same research background or mm-hmm. basic interests in sciences. So we try to make a match between the student and the advisor. And normally, every student has one advisor, but every advisor has, let's say, I personally have 20 students mm-hmm. who I advise during their whole stay at the Maastricht University in our program.
And does the student have the same advisor for the whole period of 3 years?
We aim for that, and that's normally the case.
Yes.
It can happen that a student comes in with a specific biology background or interest, mm-hmm. but switches later on to a different topic, maybe physics, and then it is possible that your advisor doesn't match anymore with your own interest. Mm-hmm. But normally, you build up a relationship with the student, so we tend to stick to the student during their whole stay here. Mm-hmm. Based on that relationship that you build with the student. But it's perfectly possible that you can switch to another advisor. But normally it's not only advising on the specific topic or the specific courses, but it's also about that relationship. So mm-hmm. things outside the courses can also be part of the meetings we have with the students.
Okay, so the topic, the field of students' interest is reflected in the field of the academic advice.
Yeah, that's what we normally mm-hmm. try to do, because then the advisor has some experience in different kinds of masters, so mm-hmm. he knows best which courses to take in order to get to a specific master in that topic area. Yes.
And how often do the students meet with the academic advisor?
We have two mandatory meetings a mm-hmm. year, so one in November. And one in May or June, and you basically build the curriculum for the next semester. Mm-hmm. So we have two mandatory meetings a year, but it doesn't stop there. So mm-hmm. you meet the students regularly. If you have a course, for example, you often talk to them, and if something comes up, they can always mail me, and then we make an appointment outside the two mandatory ones.
Mm-hmm.
So at least two, but most of the times I meet with my advisees more often than that.
Therefore, it's possible for the students to just show his or her own initiative.
Yes, if there's anything that needs a meeting or needs to talk about, if something happens, or maybe if a student wants to do a thesis abroad, then mm-hmm. it might be nice to talk about that. Or if he or she doesn't find a place to do a thesis, then mm-hmm. maybe we can help with our connections in other universities to help students to do a thesis abroad.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for being
Welcome.
Here, for answering our questions.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, let's take a closer look at a video about the academic advising, and we'll be back soon.
My name is Chris Pauling. I'm a lecturer in the science program in the topic of physics. And part of my job includes being the coordinator of academic advising in the science program, which means that I'm coordinating 20 advisors and 260 students in their advising process, ensuring that they can make informed choices about their curriculum, but also making sure that they have pastoral guidance and support while they're here in the university. The role of an academic advisor is really being the connection between the students and the university, in the sense that they, in an open curriculum, have to make informed choices about what they're studying here and how that will impact their future possibilities in terms of master programs, curriculum, and what makes a good coherent curriculum for them when they graduate. In their very first day at the science program, we give the students a questionnaire. We ask them to give us some indication about, well, what their academic aspirations are, what they're interested in, how certain they are about their studies, about different elements of the science program. And then we use that to assign somebody who has either a very similar subject area interest or somebody who we think will be a good match. Maybe they have similar personality traits, maybe they have a similar background. So a student might start in chemistry and then move maybe more into biology or into physics. It happens for all kinds of reasons. Where that happens, where the staff and the student no longer have a direct affinity, we really like to keep the relationship going between the advisor and the student. But it might be that for more subject-specific information, they have to go and find another source of advice. Or, of course, they come to my office where I have an overview of all the different areas and different people they can speak with. And so we use that as a way to ensure that people can still get good advice. Advising meetings have to take place 2 times per year, but in many cases take place many more times. The 20 or so staff members have a very close affinity with the program, so they see their students, their advisees a lot, just from virtue of being in and around the university, which means that there's a lot of informal advising moments, a 5-minute chat in the queue for lunch or while walking to the next class. Some students need more enhanced, let's say, advice, maybe in times of applying for master's programs, or if they're having some difficulties in the university, then we can set up more regular meetings. Some sessions take 5 minutes where we just sit down and we go, okay, are you finished here? Yep, pretty much I'm finished. Tick, 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 sign the box to start the bachelor thesis, and the student leaves again. Sometimes the meetings can take even longer. Normally they're scheduled for 30 minutes, but well, just 5 minutes ago I had a meeting and I just rescheduled another 30 minutes later today, because we want to really make sure that we focus and have a very clear agreement about the direction of this individual's curriculum. Advising is it sounds like a very serious and daunting prospect to a lot of people, but it's also the moment which, well, a lot of staff and students find to be the most fun. But you can see them sitting there and really making informed choices about their curriculum and really thinking about, okay, what do I want to study for the next 6 months? And it's really, for some students, it's really a conflicting decision. They want to study so many different things. Maybe they want to change direction of their curriculum. I think the fact that you can design, you have so much freedom as an individual student here, is of course one of our unique selling points, and being a part of making that run smoothly is also a very enjoyable part of my job. So,
hello everybody, welcome back to our Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. I'm Betty and I'm here with our third interviewee, who is Bart van Grinsund, again sorry for my pronunciation, who is assistant professor at the Maastricht Science Programme here. Welcome. Great. And thanks for joining us here. Maastricht Science Programme has a lab facilities at the Brightlands Chemelot campus, which is approximately 20 kilometres north from Maastricht. But no worries, students go there by public transport for free, so that's good. And Bart is here to tell us a bit more about the facilities at Chemelot campus. So,
well, we are quite spoiled. So since a year and a half, we've got a brand new building located at the Brightlands campus. We're surrounded by industry, medical industry and chemical industry. And our building is well equipped to educate students both in biology, chemistry, and physics. And next to that, we also have research labs. for the researchers in the group.
So you said industry, therefore are there also other companies at the campus? It's not
yes.
only purely university.
Well, when we look out window, we see DSM, we see mm-hmm. Subic, so we've got close relationships to them. Also, when students are doing a bit of research of their own, it is possible for them to do a project there, to do a thesis there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a strategic location, and all the industrial partners are really nearby. So they're also entangled in the research of the researchers. Students participate in the R&D departments of the company. So yeah, it's very nice to have them close by. It's a
yeah,
unique selling point.
That's very nice. Therefore, students can already get an experience from working in an industry during their bachelor's, right?
Yeah, that's very important.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's very important that students also have a look outside the warm womb of the Maastricht
mm-hmm.
Science Programme. So they have a perspective of what they can expect once they have the diploma and when they start working for a company. What's it like? What's it like outside these university walls? They need to broaden their perspective a bit.
Therefore, can students choose a project they would like to work on, or is it assigned?
No, they can choose. So we've got the project period twice a year. Once they are at a certain level, they can choose a project. They don't have to, they can choose. And what I've seen is that most students tend to like it. They like to see a company, they like to see how it works,
mm-hmm.
and they like the experience that comes with it.
I know that next to problem-based learning here at the Maastricht Science Programme, you also have something called research-based learning. So could you maybe explain what that means?
Yeah, we believe in learning by doing.
Mm-hmm.
And what we do is we try to submerge students really into research. So they have a problem and they have to solve that in an interdisciplinary manner by doing research. And they do this during project periods, but they also do it during practicals. And they do it during their thesis. So what I do as a researcher, I just let them participate in my research. It is very interdisciplinary. I need chemists, I need biologists,
mm-hmm.
I need physicists. And when they do a thesis with me, they just jump on the train on whatever we are working on, and then they get an actual feel of what it's like to be in a research group,
mm-hmm.
what it's like to have to deliver results, what's it like to publish. So we really submerge the students into research.
Could you maybe tell us a bit more about what kind of research you're working on right now with the students?
We work towards smart diagnostics. Simply put, we try to detect anything and anything.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment, we're trying to detect serotonin in blood samples, which is going really well. What we're trying to do is we're not going to beat the big companies out there on sensitivity,
mm-hmm.
but we can beat them on speed and we can on simplicity. So we're trying to make easy, accessible diagnostic tools which can be used for anyone at a very low price.
Mm-hmm.
And the students that participate are now working on more on the biological part. I'm doing the physics part, and our co-workers are working on the chemistry.
And how often do students take these skills training, if I may name it that way, of research in the Chemelos campus?
So when you do, we've got 6 periods a year.
Mm-hmm.
In one period, normally you have to take 2 courses and 1 skill.
Mm-hmm.
Next to that, you've got the project period, which is an entire period, twice a year. And you've got a thesis, which is about 5 months.
Yeah, but how often, I mean, let's say within a week?
I think if you look at a practical, that's one full-time day a week.
Mm-hmm.
The project period, that is 4 full-time weeks. And a thesis, that's 5 full-time months. So then you have to be there every day.
Okay, and just to wrap things up, tell me, how have you been experiencing the open day so far?
I think it's great. It's nice to see young students come in. They don't exactly know what they want. They don't know what to expect. And it's nice to see that they are already enthusiastic, but then to make them enthusiastic about our program. So I'm doing an RBL about measuring muscle activity,
mm-hmm.
And I'm doing the technical part. So we've got Linnea is teaching them the biology, so what is muscle activity? And then I explain a bit more about, okay, what machines should you build, how should you measure it, And it's already nice to see that you see the interdisciplinary part really at the early beginning. You've got people more interested in the biology, but you've also got people more interested in technology.
Does that mean that therefore students who are interested in a master's science program can already today try out what RBL, which is research-based learning, looks like?
Yeah, exactly. So they already get a taste of what it's like to be a student here.
It's very nice. Well, thank you very much being here, for joining us, for answering my questions. And to have a better perspective on the Camelos campus, we're now going to show you a short video about it, and we'll be soon back. Hello everyone, welcome back to the Science Program live broadcast. As Bergen mentioned in the beginning of our stream, Maastricht Science Program really takes into consideration a lot of innovation in education. The problem-based learning, for instance, or research-based learning. But for you to get a better understanding of what this is, we will now show you a video about the innovation in education, how it's taken here at the Maastricht Science Program.
Hi, I'm Donna and I teach physics here at the Maastricht Science Programme. Actually, I teach mostly maths and electronics as well, and I also work for EdLab, which is the university's department for education and innovation.
Hi, my name is Roy. I'm an evolutionary biologist here at the programme. I teach at Maastricht Science Programme plant biology, outdoor skills and other plant-related topics.
Well, I think we teach in a really changing landscape these days, and it's important to always be evolving our teaching methods in light of like new technologies evolving as well.
Yeah, I completely agree. You need to make sure that you adapt to a changing world, and you need to adapt to what students know, and that's why we need to change. We cannot stick to the traditional style of teaching that was dominating universities for such a long time. For my own class, one of the things I like to do, I'm standing right now, but I also like to stand in my classes. In a traditional setting, students sit for a long time, the tutors sit for a long time, and when you sit, you start to rest a bit, and it's not really active in a classroom. And I like to have activity in my classroom because that's good for learning. And that's why I stand up with my students in class. I have them move around a lot, I have them write on whiteboards on the wall to come up with new ideas. And in this way, it becomes really energetic in class, and students like that a lot.
To prepare students for their final exam, I also create online assessments so that the students can test themselves throughout the course. So it's not a surprise when they reach the end of the course and they sit an exam and they find out how well they're doing right at the end of the course. They can also go online, they test themselves, they find out whether their answer is right or wrong, and that means that they can go away and either do more revision or find some help if it's necessary.
One of our other colleagues, Birgit, he has students make videos for other students, and that's a very powerful way of studying topics because you need to understand the topic really well if you want to make a video about it to help other students.
So one of my colleagues, Chris Portley, he allows the students to pick their own type of assessment when they take his course. So that's really different. Instead of saying, oh, you've got to submit an essay and you've got to sit an exam, he lets the students create their own form of assessment. So students have created a video that they've submitted, or they've even created a board game to explain some theoretical concept in physics. So that's really interesting. So in a traditional university where you go to your lectures, you're just listening to information being given to you all of the time. Then when it gets to the end and you have an exam, it can be difficult to remember all of that. Whereas actually, if you've had to create your own videos or you've had to teach somebody else, then you remember that material a lot better.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the hallmarks of the Mastery Science program, is that you need to be very active, not only in your classwork, but we also run four-week projects. And in these four-week projects, you need to do research. And in that way, you learn a lot about how research works, or you get new knowledge. And at the end, you have a thesis of one full semester, which is quite unique. And there also, you need to do very much or a lot of independent work. And you learn a lot about how this works, how to run a project, etc. So this activity, this research-based learning, and we try to also incorporate it in classes, that's really important for a program.
And that they're also really essential skills for the future, because, you know, when you go out of the program, so you've got your bachelor's degree, you want to get a job, or you want to go on to a master's degree or a PhD, people don't just want people who can think and listen, people want you to be able to act on information and actually do the research and do the practical side. So in fact, in the research projects that we offer and in the theses, you also get the opportunity to work with companies. So you're getting real life experience and real life skills to help you for the future as well.
Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Mastery Science Program live broadcast. My name is Betty and I'm here with Linnea, who is a biology lecturer here at Mastery Science Program, as well as a project period coordinator.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Well, what is a project period?
So at MSP we have two project periods every academic year, and during those times, it's about 4 weeks long. Students do research projects, mm-hmm. so there are no other classes or labs scheduled during that time. So for 4 weeks, in groups of about 6 to 8 students, it's purely research, going mm-hmm. all the way from coming up with a question, designing an experiment, going to the lab to do the research, and then eventually in the fourth week to present your findings and data.
Could you tell us a bit more on why is this the project period implemented in the curriculum?
So because we're the science program, we train people to eventually become researchers, mm-hmm. potentially, and we would like our students to be exposed to the whole process of doing research. So and you cannot really mimic that in a lab setting. You have to go out and do research, come up with questions, but also run into problems, having training your ability to solve problems when your experiment doesn't go the way you expected it to go. So we think those are very valuable lessons to have within our curriculum.
Is it up to students what kind of project they would like to work on, or?
So we offer, we usually offer a whole range of projects. Mm-hmm. We offer them at different levels. So 1,000, 2,000, and 3,000 level, that's how we call them, but it's basically means that there's an increased responsibility for the student. Mm-hmm. And so in a 1,000 level project, there may be a lot of guidance from a supervisor, while in a 3,000 level project, that's less. We offer projects in all kinds of topics, and students can let us know which ones they're interested in, and then mm-hmm. we allocate them.
So is it only projects that are run by the university, or can students also join a project in an industry, for instance?
Yes, we also have projects at companies. Mm-hmm. So Bart already talked mm-hmm. a little bit about that. We have projects in collaboration with Gaia Zoo, for example, with Natural History Museum. So there are projects that are linked to science but take place outside of our program and even outside of the university. Yes.
Therefore, does the university help students to get these projects, or is it up to them to find something?
No, we offer those projects, mm-hmm. but students can also initiate their own projects. If they have a good idea that they would like to test in the lab, they can write a proposal, mm-hmm. and students can then present a proposal. We have lecturers look at it to see if it's mm-hmm. if it's feasible in 4 weeks. And then they other students can sign up, and the project can run in our Camelot labs. Mm-hmm. So there's also the possibility for students to incorporate their own ideas, test their own things that they are interested in within the project period.
You said other students can sign up, therefore yeah. the projects are done within a group?
Yes, there are always groups of students that do the project.
Mm-hmm.
And then as a group, you also evaluate at the end, so how did it go? How did our communication go in our group? Who was good at bringing in ideas? Who was good at coordinating things? So
mm-hmm.
it's evaluated in the end as well. Yes.
So how big are these groups? I mean, how big in general are the projects?
So usually around 6 students,
mm-hmm.
but sometimes up to 10. Sometimes a little bit smaller. The company projects tend to be smaller, with about 4 students. So you work quite intensely with a small group of peers.
And could you maybe tell us a bit more about maybe a research that you're doing right now with the students?
So one of the projects that's going to run in this January,
mm-hmm.
and so we have this project period twice a year, January and June. This January we have a project together with Gaia Zoo, in which
mm-hmm.
we are going to look at the behaviors of the red pandas. That's one of the new species
mm-hmm.
that they've been housing. And they are interested in a breeding program, would like to know a little bit more about the behavior of those red pandas, and we have a project on that. So that's very cool.
Yeah, it's very nice that students can actually get a hands-on experience from the actual
mm-hmm.
work.
And they will have to design what exactly they will be looking at and how they plan to tackle that. So there's also the design of an experiment is also included in the project period.
Yeah, and how have you been experiencing the open day today?
It's been a lot of fun. I've talked to a lot of
mm-hmm.
Potential students who have asked me very interesting questions about our program. Tried to compare it to more traditional programs that they may know, and try to make their choice for either our program or something else. But it's been fun to be able to tell them what the good points of our program are. Yes. I think projects is one of them, but I'm biased.
Great. Well, thank you very much for being here, for answering my questions. And now let's take a look at a video that was actually made by students during their project period about spectrography.
Sorry, I'm going. I'm just happy that our project is very straightforward. Yeah.
So when you do infrared, what you do that.
Working at Camelot is really exciting, except for the times when things go bad. But of course, you have a group to work with, and you have people double-checking your work, and you work together to solve the problem. So it always ends up good in the end. It's one of those times of the year where even though everything goes in all directions for 3 weeks, at the end, if you get the right results, it actually feels like you're doing something for a reason, and that's the coolest thing.
Welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day. I'm Betty and I'm here with another guest, this time John Sloggett, who is a lecturer of biology and a project manager thesis. So we are going to tell you a bit more about the bachelor thesis research. Therefore, could you please start with explaining what is bachelor thesis research?
Right, well, the bachelor thesis is the grand finale of the studies at the MSP.
Mm-hmm.
In the previous 5 semesters, you'll have done courses, skills and projects. And in the bachelor thesis, you get to basically integrate all that together in one piece of research, which you will do with researchers.
Mm-hmm.
And you will go all the way through that piece of research on your own, designing it, making a proposal, then actually doing the research, and after that reporting on it, writing a thesis, and also having a defense.
How much time do students have for this whole process?
So it's a whole semester. Mm-hmm. So it's basically 1/6 of your study time while you're at the MSP. So it's quite a long piece of research. It's longer than some other universities.
And can students choose from a range of topics?
Yes, of course. By the time that students start their bachelor thesis research, they will already have a very good idea of what it is that interests them. And so the students can basically choose the subject of their research themselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a little bit like in the projects, but the difference is that basically they go out and they find somebody to supervise them, mm-hmm. and so therefore they have a much broader range of things that are open to them. It's not like there's a list and they choose from a list. In this particular case, they go to people and they find a piece of research to do in the same way that a master's or a PhD student might.
Mm-hmm. And the thesis supervisors, that's academic staff from here, from the Master Science program?
The thesis supervisor can be from the MSP, but mm-hmm. it very often is not. We have a few, we have people who do research in the MSP, and students can do bachelor theses with those, but the majority of our students go outside the MSP. They either go into the wider university, mm-hmm. so they go to other departments and do research with people there. Or they may leave the university completely, they may leave the Netherlands completely, they may leave the continent of Europe completely, and they may go somewhere completely different to do their research. So, for example, we've had students in South America doing research on coral reefs, for example. So, basically, they can go anywhere in the world if they can find a researcher who's willing to take them.
Is it possible to do this research also in an industry, in a company?
Yes, it is. And we've had a number of students who have gone out to do research with companies. Mm-hmm. They get to experience a somewhat different environment there. I mean, Bart's already talked about it, I think, with respect to projects. Mm-hmm. But they get to experience a somewhat different research environment there. But at the end of the day, the aim is the same. So they are carrying out a piece of sort of like self-standing research. And at the end of it, they have to analyse and report on their data.
Yeah, at the beginning you said that the students need to defend their thesis, right? How does this look like?
Yeah, that's right. Basically, they defend their thesis in front of an audience of their peers. So mm-hmm. there will be other students there who've also finishing their bachelor thesis. There will also be staff from the MSP there. There will likely be outside academics there. Their research supervisor may be there. Of course, if their research supervisor comes from South America, that's less likely to be the case. But there will be a mixture of academic staff and students there, and they will give a presentation on their thesis, and they will then be subject to a small grilling to defend it, yes.
Yeah. And after that,
I feel the bachelor thesis is a very good introduction mm-hmm. to the world of research. Mm-hmm. A lot of students will go on to do masters where they will go on to do more research. And I feel that the bachelor thesis research is a very good way of leading on into that next stage of their careers. And indeed, if they don't go on to masters and they go out into jobs, you still have that organisational component. So, you know, they've done something that is theirs.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Thank you for joining us here. And right now we're going to mute our microphones for a bit because we're going to change them. And we'll soon be back with two current students to interview. Welcome back to the Maastricht Science Program Open Day broadcast. I'm Betty, and we're lucky enough to have two current students here. Martin, who is from Thailand.
Half Thai, half Dutch.
Yes, and Ariane, who's from Germany. It's good to have you here. Well, let's start a bit broadly and just tell me, why did you choose Maastricht Science Program for your studies?
Okay, well, I personally wasn't exactly sure what I wanted to do later. And I only knew that I really liked the natural sciences in general. And I think for this, this program is of course perfect, because you can still, again, try every direction of it and then see what you really like and mm-hmm. still choose in a way that you combine different fields. So that was my reason.
Yeah, I also I knew that I was interested in science, but I had no idea what direction specifically I wanted mm-hmm. to go to. But that's why I chose the Maastricht Science Program, so I could pick and choose whatever courses really interested me.
Mm-hmm. And in what fields are you interested the most?
I'm going towards biology and medicine more.
Yeah, and I do mainly chemistry, and I'm very interested in material science. And that is exactly why this program is so cool, because I basically didn't do chemistry in high school. Mm-hmm. So due to the intro period, I was able to catch up with it and realize I actually really like it, and then continue choosing those courses.
And we've talked about the project period before already. So could you maybe tell us what projects you've worked on previously?
Well, I'm still technically first year, mm-hmm. so I've only had one project, and mm-hmm. that was about growing phytoplankton, which are these unicellular algae that grow in the ocean, but we had to try and find the best conditions that they would grow in. It took a lot of time, but it was pretty interesting.
And was it successful?
It was not.
Well, there are also researches like that, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
And you?
Well, I had some more projects, Martin.
Yeah.
I would say my most successful one was when we tried to differentiate between plant species mm-hmm. using spectroscopy, so shooting IR beams at it, basically. And that went so well that we will actually soon will have a paper published if everything goes the right way. So that was really cool, and we worked very independently, so it was a lot of fun. It felt very like in real life, basically.
It's really good to know that students can actually get into publishing yeah. already during their bachelor's, right?
If you work well.
Very nice. But could you tell us what was so far your most favorite thing or most favorite part of the Maastricht Science Program? What you like the most?
So far, I really like that it's after you pass the intro period and you start doing the electives, then you mix in with all the other year groups, and it's mm-hmm. like everyone just mixes together, which is quite nice, because usually you have the separation of year groups because everyone's doing different courses. Mm-hmm. But I really like that everyone mingles together, and it's a very family kind of feel, I guess.
Yeah, that's definitely true, that everything is so familiar here and you know the professors very well, which is very different from Germany, for example. Mm-hmm. And I also like that in a way you can have more responsibility if you want to, because as we talked about the projects before, we are also able to apply to lead our own project. So then we have the responsibility of leading a whole research project, and that is really cool, I think, which you would definitely not be able to do at other universities, I think.
Well, since you've already touched upon it, the differences from Germany. So coming from abroad, how is the life here in Maastricht in general?
Coming from Thailand, it's a lot colder, and but everything's a lot closer, because mm-hmm. in Thailand you need a car to go anywhere, but here you can walk or take your bike, and I like that everything's a lot cozier in a way, besides the cold.
That's really good, because I basically I live very close to all of my friends, because the city is not that big, and it's also very international, and it happens so often to me that I meet people on the streets that I know, even though we still are quite a few people here, of course. So I don't know, it's just different from the way that people live here with the mm-hmm. transport and everything, and it's very cute. Yeah.
Could you just shortly tell us something about the student life in Maastricht?
student life.
Yes.
Well, there's a lot of sports associations,
mm-hmm.
and I personally, I'm playing rugby, and I just started this year. But if you want to balance like doing sports and university, you really have to be organized, otherwise everything kind of falls apart.
Sounds very negative. Well, apart from the uni sports, we also have different sports, of
mm-hmm.
course, from the local clubs,
mm-hmm.
because I personally didn't do any of the university sports yet, and they also are very welcoming. It's often then, of course, in Dutch, but they will also translate it for you, because most people here speak English very well. So there are many opportunities even outside of university, and we have a lot of more social clubs too, where you can get involved with the Amnesty International Association,
mm-hmm.
of course, or things in that direction.
Yeah, so it's really good to know that even though Maastricht is not the biggest city ever, there are still plenty of activities you can attend to apart from the university, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
That's
you. Well, thank you very, very much for being here, for answering my questions. And right now, let's take a look at a short video about the student life in Maastricht.
Is heavy with the thought of you. The moment I wake, I'm chasing signs. Never give up, I never give up. It's never enough, it's never enough. You're not the one. Scared that the sun won't shine on me. I've been holding on for some kind of miracle.
Hello and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. So far, we've learned a lot about how the program looks like, about the project period, the research-based learning, but we haven't touched upon the probably the most interesting questions for all of you prospective students, and that's the admission procedure. That's why we have here Monique, who is a communication officer here at Maastricht Science Program. Thanks for joining us.
Yes.
And so could you maybe start by saying, for what kind of students is the Maastricht Science Program suitable?
Basically, we're looking for students who are interested in natural sciences.
Mm-hmm.
Can be the whole natural sciences, or biology, or chemistry, or physics, or math only. but most of all we're looking for people who have a broad interest in the sciences, who are curious to explore different disciplines within the sciences, who like to study in an international environment,
mm-hmm.
because we have so many different nationalities, who like to work together, because during the practicals and skills trainings you have to work in teams, but also students who can study independently, because you have to be prepared for every tutorial, which is different from the skills, of course. So yeah, in a nutshell, that will be the student who we're looking for and who we think will fit in the program and in the community.
And how does the admission procedure itself look like? So what do the students need to do, actually?
Yeah, well, first you go to the StudyLink website, which mm-hmm. is a national website where you will register yourself for the study you'd like to go to.
Mm-hmm.
And then you will be invited to upload documents, in our case, a letter of motivation, and your grade list, your latest grade list. And based on that, you will be invited for an interview. The interview can take place via Skype or in person, depending on where you
mm-hmm.
live. And after the interview, you will hopefully be invited to start with the program or not. It's all depending on your motivation, basically, and a little bit on your grades.
Mm-hmm. And who is interviewing the prospective students, actually?
It's our admissions officer,
mm-hmm.
who is Nicola Felix, also always together with an academic, so
mm-hmm.
with a teacher. So always two people interviewing the prospective students. Yeah.
Are there any, since the program is in English, right? So are there any requirements for the knowledge of English of students?
Yes, if you're not native English, if you're not a native English
yeah.
speaker or did your high school in English,
mm-hmm.
then you must submit an English test,
mm-hmm.
A TOEFL or ELTS test. They both will do.
And when can the students start studying the program?
Yeah, we have two intake moments, one in February and one in September.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, two intake moments. So the intake for February, the deadline is passed. The deadline is the 1st of November to apply for
mm-hmm.
February. The deadline for September 2018,
mm-hmm.
sorry, will be the 1st of May. If you're a European student, if you're from outside the European Union, it will be the 1st of April.
And are there any other requirements that differ for European students and for students outside of Europe?
No, we only have a difference in deadline because
mm-hmm.
of visa, because we have to arrange visa administrative things for that. That's why it takes a bit longer.
Mm-hmm. It might seem quite unusual that there's actually the possibility to start in February.
Yeah.
So are there any differences in how many people start in September and in February?
Yes. In February we usually start with around 20 students.
Mm-hmm.
Last year we started with 22 students,
mm-hmm.
but more or less around 20. And in September this year we started with 116 students. But that can rise a little bit more. So around 120, and in total 140 students can start with the program.
Yeah, but do the studies look the same?
Yes. So the February group also
mm-hmm.
starts with the core courses.
Mm-hmm.
The first half year is the core. And yeah, if you start in September, again, the first half year will be the core as well.
Therefore, students who would apply in February, let's say, they don't need to worry that they will miss on something that happened previously.
No. It only starts at a different time, but the program is set up the same.
Well, okay. Well, thank you very much for joining us and for answering the most important questions. And Maastricht Science Program is relatively new. It only started in 2011. Therefore, so far there's only been 3 years of graduates, and only recently there has been an alumni conference of the Maastricht Science Program. Right now we're going to show you a video from this conference, and after that we will join back with summarizing up of the open day. So enjoy.
Let's conference also be a great demonstration that once you're MSP, you're always MSP. And when you graduate, you never leave the MSP behind. Because the MSP community is always so beautiful, so harmonious.
you know, to learn something, you know, you always learn in August the wonderful things about the university.
And to see the program developing in such a positive way is amazing.
Your background is to sell it.
We're going to be the people that think out of the box. And that's extremely beneficial in research, because you're going to see professors going to highlight their eyes and just thinking, wow, you're really clever.
Yeah, I mean, alumni conference is the best. I think, you know, like today it was very well organized.
First of all, the project periods were great because we were able to like design our own projects as well. And that kind of freedom, especially as an undergrad, is like rare.
Yeah,
like,
definitely.
Very,
kind
very
of independent.
Have that, and that the trust and independence that the staff gives you here is great.
That's what I want. I want people to say MSP is where you gotta be.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the last part of the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. Right now I'm back here with current student Martin and Birgit, the academic staff, and my question is, how have you been experiencing the Open Day so far?
Well, I think it's been very busy today. There's been a lot of people, about 300 or so. We've had a lot of interested students asking lots of questions. And lots of exciting activities. So we had two research-based learning exercises, one in chemistry and one which was sort of interdisciplinary. We had a science fair going where lots of experiments were going on, distillation, for example, an information booth on the research that we're doing here. So yeah, I think it's been a very informative day for the public.
Yeah, I was part of the research-based learning, the interdisciplinary one. I was one of the guinea pigs, as you can see there. But basically, we just had to show how muscles contract and measured it. And we got the students to design an experiment to see how it worked.
Well, that means that the Open Day is pretty interactive, right?
It is, absolutely, yes.
Yeah, we were running a chemistry research-based learning on chromatographic separation, so separating compounds with containing metals using something called thin layer chromatography. So we've been running those sessions through the course of the day, and I think that's also been very interactive, and I think the students are really enjoying it.
Yeah, I think it's also very nice that the students can really get a hands-on experience of how it is to actually study here, not just like hearing a boring session on blah 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 blah, this is Maastricht Science Program, but really try it out, which is pretty nice.
Yes, and actually during the year, you know, people can come and visit our program, interested students, and be a student for a day, for example, and also if they miss the Open Day, they can actually they can do stuff like that. So, I agree with you. I think it's much more interesting to do something interactive in the spirit of the Maastricht Science Programme rather than just hearing information. But of course, we have those information sessions as well.
You said of being a student for a day. Could you maybe explain what that means? Because
we have a marketing and communications person here, Monique Skierbus, and she actually coordinates this. So if we have interested students who want to come and experience the program, there's a number of ways that they can actually do it. They can make a personal appointment and actually talk to an academic staff member, or they can come and actually spend a day here and be a student for a day. And so we have these possibilities for them to really experience the Maastricht Science Programme as a student.
So that way they join lectures and
PBL lectures, exactly.
Yeah, usually the student gets assigned to another Maastricht Science Programme student, and then they shadow the student and follow them around, see what goes on with life here at the Maastricht Science Programme.
Well, you also, since you're here as participating as a current student throughout the Open Day, does that mean you also work for the university?
Yes, I work as a promo teamer, and essentially we kind of get out there and talk about how great the program is.
Well, so the promo team is a very, very big part of our Open Day, and you know, the students that really are enthusiastic about the program and help us run things. So that's very nice, I think. And let's hope that they help cleaning up today.
Of course.
Well, it's really nice to know that as a student you can also make some money aside by working for the university, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's also quite enjoyable because you're working with friends and other staff that you see all the time.
Well, are there any last words or message you would like to bring to our audience, to our prospective students, about the Maastricht Science Programme?
Well, I would say if you've missed the open day today, that's not the end of the world. We have open days twice a year, in November and February. So there's another opportunity or another moment for students to come and experience it. And if they have the time, they can also make an appointment to actually come and see the program for themselves and be a student for a day. So I think there's lots of possibilities to really explore the program in that way. And of course, we've got lots of information online. These videos, I think, will be stored on our YouTube website. So yeah, I think the information is out there and people should just really look into it.
He said about everything, really, but
maybe something from the student's perspective.
Well, if you love science but you really don't know what you want to specify into, I think this is an excellent program. Especially because I was doing chemical engineering before and then I did not like it at all, but I'm really enjoying this program now.
I would like to just comment on that. Even if you do know what you want to study, it's possible, that's an important point. So if you, for example, very early on, you just want to study biology, then then you can do that. So we cater for both students. That's a very, I think, important point. It's not just for interdisciplinary students or students that are not sure. We cater for those, but we also cater for people that do know what they want to do. And if they want to do something very specific, that's possible as well. So that's the idea behind the program.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you both of you for joining us, for answering the questions, for being on the live stream. And thank you all for watching. I hope you gathered all the important information you needed. And if not, just check out the official Maastricht University website, contact us anytime, and we'll tell you what you need to know. So that's all from me, from our guests. And hope you enjoy the broadcast. Bye.